We're very, very honored to have you, Suely, here, to having made the effort to be with us.
I just start apologizing my English, which not that good. It was very difficult to choose what is the point to bring here, no? And I'm not sure that is totally clear for me. Anyway, it is a part of a work of elaboration that I'm doing since last years, and it will be a new book. And it is on the invisible or unsayable dimension of modernity in Western societies and Westernalized societies by colonizations, which of course can't be separate, as Walter Mignolo highlighted many times in the first keynote. What it's about, what I call a colonial unconscious. And this colonial unconscious is still here, is still there, and is still everywhere. He is still here, no, of course. He is still here. And it goes on structuring our subjectivities, our desire, and the production of our thinking. So what I will share with you is some instruments to characterize what I call the colonial unconscious, especially the politics of production of thought that correspond to it. The title of my presentation would Micropolitics of Thinking, Suggestions to Those Who Seek to Deprogram the Colonial Unconscious. And I will start with a William Blake quote from the 18th century. He who desires but acts not breathes pestilence. Expect poison from the standing water. For me, it's amazing and nice the way that he could think and do things like that, and ideas like those, and poems like those, in 18th century, the century of enlightenment. At the beginning, the origin of the stronger operation, what I call the colonial unconscious in the production of thought, which we are totally under influence of that today. Even if we don't desire, we don't want, but this is a struggle. It's not done, no? Bom, I will take as a departure point a proposition of Lygia Clark walking, caminhando, walking. This proposition came from a study she was doing to a new series of her bichos. She was making a new kind of research to a new series of bichos with topological spaces and topological surfaces. And she was trying to work with the Möbius strip, no, this topological surface. So she was making this research with this strip. She was cutting the surface of the strip. And suddenly, during her act of cutting, she realized that the œuvre d'art, the artwork, or the art experience, was in the act of cutting. Because through the act of cutting, she was experiencing a new way of seeing and a new way of feeling time and space. A time without before and after, a space without inside, outside, down and below. Bon, you understand, no? Bajo y alto, etc., etc., etc. So she realized that this is the work of art, and not the object that will result from that act. From then on, she entered in a three-year crisis because of this experience, because it was impossible to go back to her previous artistic practices, to paintings and objects and etc. From then on, she invented a lot of propositions in order to keep going affirming the importance of art practicing. Huh? So she never abandoned art. But what matters for me in through this work, what I want is, first of all, I will just describe in it, the what how it was this proposition. No, she just gave to the public a pair of scissors, a paper strip, and glue with four instructions. First instruction, twist a paper strip and glue onto one of its ends the reverse side of the other end. Second instruction, choose any point of the surface and begin cutting from there along the strip. Third one, just one warning, and this is very important and you see why. Each time you reach a point you had cut before, avoid it in order to continue cutting. And four, continue cutting along the strip until the surface is exhausted and there is no more space for a new cut. So, what I propose, first of all, is to observe different consequences of your act depending on the kind of cuts you choose during your own walking, to diversify or to reproduce. First choice, to diversify. That means to produce differences, following Lygia's instructions. So you cut when you find a point that you have already cut, you just make a shift and you choose another point and you go on cutting and so on and so on and so on. And the result is this multiplicity of forms. Because when you don't have any more surface to cut, the strip re-became a B-face strip with outside and inside, and it's finished. So let's see what happens when you cut at the same points that where you had already cut before. So second choice, to reproduce, ignoring Lygia's instruction. So you cut. When you find a point that you had already cut, you cut again at the same point, and you go on. And this is a result, a very poor repetition of the same shape. This shape is exactly the same at the beginning, but it is only growing and growing and growing, or being fat, but it's exactly the same shape. So there is a big difference between this image, this result of a kind of act, and this result, no? So now I am going to what really matters for me, is to extract from this experience a way to think at two different capacities of our organ of sense to approach the world. And this is not a neutral question. So I ask you to imagine that the world, or every world, is a Möbius strip. The world, or every world, is a topological relational surface made of bodies of all kinds, of course not only human, in diverse and variable connections. And this field, this topological relational surface, this composition of bodies in different connections, in movement, constitutes a Möbius strip. And what I propose, that one side is forms and the other side is forces. So a world, the world, every world, is this topological relational surface made of bodies of all kinds that has two sides that are totally inseparable. This grid is the generical representation of man, woman, man. The experience of the forms, which is very, we are very used to this capacity of our sense organs is molded by the representations associated to the forms within the current cultural cartography. So this experience, it operates through perception, which we know very well, you know? The retina, for instance, the retina of the eye. Retina is only a part of it, the sensible experience. So through perception and through affection, the psychological emotion or feelings. And both perception and affection is, they form the experience of the subject. But the subject is only a part of the subjectivity. And perception and affection are only a part of our sense organs capacities. So we can qualify this experience as sensible, because it's sensibility, the perception, sensible, subjective, because it's the experience of a subject, and cultural, because it is totally structured and molded by our cultural repertoire, and experience of our world in its actual form, the familiar. It is familiar because it belongs totally to our cultural repertoire. But there is another capacity of our sense organs. It's the experience of forces of our world, which is not through perception and affection or emotional feeling. This experience is generated by the forces effects on our body, and I'm qualifying this capacity of the body as resonating, relational body. It has nothing to do with aesthetic or relational aesthetic. The experience of the forces is the experience of the effects of the forces on our resonating relational body. And it's operate not through perception and affection, but through percept. Percept is a delusion word. The percept is a new way of seeing. As I said, that Lygia, when she was cutting, she made this experience of a new way of seeing and you of feeling the space and time, and she said, this event is the work of art, no? So it's a new way of seeing, a new of feeling. So the motion of those, the effects of this living body on us, it's a vital emotion. It's not the ego emotion. This vital emotion is a kind of another way of seeing, another way of feeling, no? As when you were describing those experience with the indigenous, and you are saying that what Rondoni wanted to share, to express, it was the experience, his experience, or I understood the effects of that experience in his body, and he tried to make this sensible, no? Perhaps we are talking about that. But what, and also when Raymond Chavez, when they presented this project through drawings, I understood that they were trying something through that. But for me, there is something that I want to share here, is the only moment when there was a kind of melancholy here in this room. And it's strange because we are here in order to share an effort to affirm something that has to do with what we call Latin American. So the percept and affect they form the experience of a subjectivity. So I highlight subjectivity outside of the subject, which means that subjectivity is not only the subject. There is a zone outside of the subject, which is a zone where our relational resonant body is affected by the forces of the world or is affected by otherness. So if there, as I spoke about, a sensible, subjective, cultural experience of a world in its actual form, the familiar, here you have the asubjective, aesthetical experience of a world in its virtual state. And it is the strange, or the unhomely. It is the strange because it's exactly what is escape of our cultural repertoire. But it escape not as a exoteric, I don't know what stuff, It escapes as the most material and real stuff. It escapes because of the effects of the environment on our body and through our experience all the time. And it's strange, first of all, because it has not image, neither word. It's just a new way of feeling and seeing. And it's strange because it can't be just translated by our cultural repertoire. And in our culture, it's much more strange than that. Because, and I will speak a little bit more about that after, because we are not used to activate this capacity. On the contrary, if some indigenous cultures, there is different cultural rules in order to support and go on with that and deal with that and protect that it's a shared experience that go on and go on. In our culture, on the contrary, all our rituals and rules are against the possibility to activate this experience. So what is really important about all this is that we are always experiencing at the same time the strange and the familiar, and it is inseparable. So the idea of uncanny, which is in Portuguese we translate by estranho familiar, no? Between the experience of forces and the experience of forms, there is a paradoxical relation. It's not dialectical at all. It's not that the experience of force is in opposition of the experience of force, in opposition of the experience of forms, or it's not opposition, it's not the negation. It's something that functions in a total other logic of experience, no? But they are indissociable, it's a Möbius strip, so it's indissociable. When you make the experience with the Möbius strip, what is inside become outside, what is force become. So what is force become form. So you can't separate. And this paradoxical relation produce this uncanny, and we are very often taken by this disquietude of this uncanny. Something is there, but something is not there. Like a little bit this character of Woody Allen in Deconstructing Harry, you are there, but suddenly your face disappears, you don't know very well who you are, where you are. Something is not there anymore, but it's not there yet. And this question mark, this unavoidable paradox poses a problem to decide, because this question mark and this unease, as it produces a kind of vital disequilibrium, it convokes desire, and this is the task of desire, to act in order to produce or to find or to create a new vital equilibrium for a while, no? And desire's action is inseparable, is the same time a movement of thought. And this problem is accessed by sensation, so desire will deal with this problem, and desire will act in order to rearrange, to invent something that will recover a kind of equilibrium, a kind of sense. Depending on the way we deal with this disquietude, with this unease, with the fragility that subjectivity lives in those experiences, which are always there, depending on that, there are many different politics of desire to recover a kind of equilibrium. And these different politics of desire, they correspond to different politics of production of thought. And this is what matters to us, because my point here is to try to share an idea about what means Western, modern, colonial way of thinking and way of being. Okay. So, I will just point out two extremes of micropolitics of thinking, acting. Of course, it doesn't exist as such in reality, because everyone and every culture is a mix of different positions all over an existence, no? So I, from one extreme, I will present a reactive micropolitics. What I call micropolitics here is this is the politic of desire, and this precise politics of the way we deal with this unease of this tension between forces and formers in our subjectivity. So, if we have a reactive micropolitics, I call it, to be short, anthropophallogocentric thinking. It's a thinking which is homogenetic, identitarian, colonial, capitalistic, and he functions following a moral compass. And the other extreme, an active micropolitics, which I will call anthropophagic thinking, heterogenetic, relational, immanent, perspectivist, and its ethical compass. Now, just to make a little parenthesis, because Adriano spoke about anthropophagy half an hour ago, and I think there is some elements of the anthropophagical ritual that is very can be very productive to share with you in order to understand that, because we have this general idea that anthropophagy is a cannibalism, no? That anthropophagy consists to eat the other in order to eat the enemy in order to take his forces and values inside us and to hybrid this with our own culture. Okay, to be short, no? But the anthropophagical ritual is infinitely more complex than that, and it lasts long time. So I speak only about two phases of this ritual. When the enemy is captured, first of all, he stays with the women of the tribe for months, year, 2 years, 3 years, but not to be tortured or something like that, as in the bourgeois conjugality, no? Just to be there, to have fun, you can have babies, okay. At the same time, the women, they are preparing the ibirapema, is the baston, como se dice, el palo este, club, which the enemy will be killed, okay? So, what is the moment when the tribe decide that he will be killed, to take out from the women and be killed, is exactly the moment when a process of assimilation begins. There is no tension anymore with this this otherness. There is an incredible performance of the killer and the person who will be killed. They perform their culture, their traditions, the relation between those two cultures since the past, and then he's killed. And then he'll be the cannibalistic moment. The second point, very important, is the only person that doesn't participate to the cannibalism feast is the man who killed, the guerrero, warrior. Oh, I should know this word. Warrior, the warrior who killed. So this guy, he don't eat, he don't stay, he goes out very far away from the tribe, and he stays there for months or many months, and he only go out from there when he arrived to have a new name and new drawings in his body. It's a new name that is added to his previous name, and new drawings that are added to the previous drawing, they are not erased, and then he come back to the tribe. This is a ritual to maintain the access to the effects of otherness in the body, and to maintain this work of desire to invent something, a name, word, flesh, another form of the flesh. It's like a becoming of his subjectivity, unleashed by those effects. And when he come back, this becoming belongs to the whole community. Let's see, first of all, the active micropolitics. I cut, mobilize, trying to invent a cut with my question mark, not avoiding. On the contrary, I'm trying to cut impulsed by my question mark. And I go on, and I go on, and I go on, and I go on, and this is the kind of life I produce with that kind of attitude. A singular life, a noble life, a life. But if I, now I want to just to share with you this quote by Guattari. We will talk here preferably of a proto-aesthetic paradigm with the intention to indicate that we are not referring to institutionalized art, not to the artworks as they manifest in the social field, but instead to a dimension of creation in its initial state, a power of emergence endlessly subsuming the contingent. So we are not talking here only about when desire cuts, when desire cut, following the question mark, following the sensation of this tension between the familiar and the strange, the uncanny, following the uncanny. Desire is trying to invent through his act something that will be bearer of this experience. There is a performativity of this experience in what will be created. This creation can be an art work, but it can be another way of living sexuality. It can be a text, writing, etc., etc., etc. The problem is that this capacity in Western and Westernalized society has been confined in a zone called, since the 80s, art. The problem is that it's getting worse and worse, because if it was just a concentration camp of the possibility of affirming life as a potency of creation, the possibility to create something that is bearer of what is seeking to come, no? Something that is the real, shared by everybody, but it is also in your body, and it's your way to bring it and to reconfigure the present. It was concentrated in art camp, so concentration camp of the essence of life as power of creation and differentiation. Now, under cognitive capitalism, it became a kind of extermination camp. Because even there is a kind of operation of pimping of this potency. What matters is the dimension of creation in its initial state, a power of emergence endlessly subsuming the contingent. Now, let's see what matters with reactive micropolitics, what I call anthropophallogocentric thinking, homogenetic, identitarian, colonial, capitalistic, and its moral compass. Desire makes its cuts, but avoiding all the time the question mark. And the result is this kind of life, a generic life, a sterile life, a miserable life. Okay. Why I said ethical compass and moral compass? If you understand the essence of life is a power of creation and differentiation, an endless power of creation and differentiation, when I made my, when desire made its cut, trying to invent something that will be a bearer of this tension, and it will result in something that you reconfigure the actual cartography, when desire is doing that, what he's orienting desire is not just life, is the will to protect and to affirm life. But if I have my experience of forces totally anesthetized, if I have my access to sensation, to this tension between forms and forces, totally obstructed, but I am in this unease anyway, I can avoid it. So I have two possibilities. Or I take chemic in order to neutralize everything quickly, or instead of consuming pharmacology medicaments, I can consume drug, but I can consume everything. I can consume, for instance, new clothes because I'm feeling like deconstructing Harry, but now you buy in New York some clothes and I feel again stable in a kind of image of myself and everything will be okay. Or I can also consume Deleuzean theory. It's the same. It's the same because my relation to that is a consumption relation that I repeat in order to recover a kind of stability. So what orient the desire, the politics of desire, the act of desire, is a moral compass. We talk a lot about post-colonial, but I feel a lack of those dimensions. Before saying that, it's important to say that for me, from a micropolitical point of view, the main operation of Western modernity culture, including colonization, because it's not separable, of course, we are just an unfold of one logic, one same logic. We can say, I totally agree with Walter Mignolo. So, but if we take that from a micropolitical point of view, for me, the most important and successful micropolitical operation of that culture is the anesthesia of what I call body knowing body, the anesthesia of this capacity to be affected by the world as a field of forces, and this obstruction of our access to sensation, to this tension, in order to affirm the ethical, political, and cultural function of thought. Thought becomes totally submitted, no matter what, to consume. We are like zombies that lose totally our life compass in order to take our choice, to take our decisions, and to invent and reinvent life. I agree that the Western modern culture is inseparable from colonization. Those different micropolitics are there everywhere. From a micropolitical point of view, this active or reactive micropolitics, they are not a privilege of a geographic place in the planet, no? So what I proposed differently of that is a permanent decolonization of the unconscious and its creative eruptions. And to finish, I have 8 suggestions to decolonize the unconscious, you see? De-anesthetizing the vulnerability to the forces, reactivating the knowing body, unobstructing the access to sensations, keeping oneself within the tension of the uncanny until an utterance capable of actualizing it, bearing its pulsation, is created. Holding on to the temporality of the creative process. Don't let this temporality be totally disturbed by our own stupidity and all those demanding around us, especially in art world, no? Bon. Holding on, those vernissages, holding on to desire, not negotiating the unnegotiable. Ah, there is 2-8, huh? exercising thought in its ethical, political, and clinical function. So, to finish, this presentation is dedicated to all those who desire and act, because if you desire and don't act, you breathe pestilence. To all those who, with their acts of creation, driven by desire, try to convert, revert, pervert, subvert, deprogram, deinstall, de-establish, deconfigure, defetishize, disarm, undo, take down, empty, or simply quit with the colonial unconscious. Thank you. Yes, Cecilia, come here.
Thank you so much. It's really an honor. I mean, your Molecular Revolution book with Guattari is on my desk all the time, in my mind. I have something about your talk is troubling to me.
What?
It's troubling. I think the emphasis on art as new, as novelty, as opening up new time and space, it seems to me that novelty, the newness, might be this colonial value, a kind of fetishism of the foreign. So why this privilege of novelty? When you say that, for example, then, or counterexample, you say that, yes, you said that art is the opening of new times and spaces.
I did that percept and affect, what I call ecstatic experience, which means, because it's different when Walter Mingolo said aesthetic was talking about senses, sensibility. I'm talking about the effect of the living world in our body, the effect of forces in our body. This is aesthetic experience, which can be in art or not, because art is only the place where it was not forbidden to be in touch with that.
Yes. I worry, though, about jettisoning stability entirely. It occurs to me that maybe we need a level of stability in order for certain politics, whether they be active or reactive, to be possible at all.
Ah, yes. But now I understand your concern. So, I was a little bit provocative, not taking those very extreme examples. But what I mean is, it's as there are different politics of production of thought, there are different politics of relation of the thinking of other authors. No, for instance, when I went to Deleuze classes at the 70s, no, I live in Paris, all the 70s in Israel, I didn't understand French. I didn't understand anything about his talking about, but I felt something in his attitude, in his gestures, the way that he talked to people, etc. It's just something that helped me to bring back my subjectivity and my potency, my living power to think and to create. So I'm not saying that Deleuze is bullshit, Marx is bullshit. I love those guys. The problem is not that. The problem is the relation that you establish with that. When I created a PhD in Universidade Católica de São Paulo since many years, no? Since 35 years, when I came back from France. And we have a kind of free zone there, no? In academic. And I think that we must invest. We must occupy, as Walter said, we must occupy the institution. In this free zone there, when somebody comes to make to be a candidate to go in to make his thesis or master, we don't want him to bring any project, any question, and any, as you used to say, your theoretical basis, your question, your methodology. We just don't want, when somebody very sick, totally pathologically structured in that tradition, we don't want him with us. What we want is to feel that he is in a kind of unease, that he is in his, like, in this uncanny. He wanted to elaborate something that he doesn't know even how to say it. And then this is good for us. And our work collectively is in order to try to give words to that, no? In this case, through a thesis. So the thesis is a becoming of his thought, but of his own way of being and of his subjectivity. It's not just like something separate of what he's fighting for in his life. And also today we don't talk anymore. We decided we will not name anymore objet de recherche, research object. We don't say this anymore. We say, what are your erogenous zones? What do we mean? We mean that in our Western colonized modern culture, life, eros, which is totally perverse polymorph, as Freud said, no? Eros is practically reduced to sexuality. And when we listen the idea of that libido is eros is perverse polymorph perverse, we understand that it's not only genital. There are all kind of other things that we can explore in sexuality. The connections that can bring life orgasms are much more extended than sexuality, no? And we think that thinking and creating is a major erogenous zone. If we really deal with that, if we really take it not as glamorous stupidity, but as something really fundamental, it makes life, enjoying life, is affirmed as power of creation and differentiation. But if I understand that subjectivity is the subject, but also this zone where I am totally affected by the forces of the world, my act of creating is to make sayable or make it visible or in short, make sensible something that is present as the most real in all the bodies of the same context, as in my body, as is what Guattari calls agencement collectif d'énonciation. I mean, those forces, we share them, and they are present in all our bodies in different ways. When I deal with the unease between those effects, the effects of those forces, and what's going on, for instance, the unease between the effects of my experience in art world and the repertoire I have to deal with that, when I don't obstruct this, trying to quickly make something to become, when I stay in this unease, and I succeed to do something, or, for instance, this conference that is bearer of that tension, what I made came out of my mouth in a singular way. But it doesn't come from my own belief. It comes from a shared experience of forces that are present in my body as well. So what I make is something that reconfigure, that contributes to the reconfiguration of a shared situation, a shared cartography. Tanya, se diga.
Thank you, everyone. I want to thank especially the public that stayed with us all day and was here. It was a long session, many different topics, ideas, exchange. Especially, I want to thank all our speakers for being here, Walter and Suely. Mari Carmen, Gerardo, Max, Tania, Luis, Marilis, Raymond, Gilda, Julieta, Adriano, Tobias, Jens, Sofia, for being here, and all the team at the Guggenheim, which made this possible, Christina Young and all her team, Jennifer Allen, Sarah, Evelyn, and Alessandra, and Brenda in production and her team. Finally, thanks to our sponsors, UBS, a cultural engagement, which makes possible to have this reunion of people here. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.